Good morning and welcome to The Discussion. I'm your host, Luke Davino, and tonight on our panel, I'll be joined by Liam Duff and John Kostrunas. On this episode of The Discussion, we will be talking about a very serious issue tackling our society. This issue is mental illness, and in particular, anxiety.
Currently in Australia, anxiety is the most prevalent out of all mental issues at 16% of all cases. It is estimated that 50% of all people living in Australia will experience a type of mental health issue at some point in their life. To have a good mental health, it is to manage life well and to be able to be more resilient in tough times. Mental illness is a series of issues that affect the way you think or feel. It is believed that these issues may be gene-related or can develop due to stress in one's life. Anxiety being the leading mental issue in Australia, it is directly linked to the ATSI population, which is the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander community, and it is also the leading mental health issue there. Anxiety levels were high amongst victims of violence, which is 46%, and for those who were removed from their natural families, which is in regards to the stolen generation, which is 39%. And one out of four reported that their physical health was the main cause of these feelings.
To give us a fundamental understanding of what anxiety is, our reporter Mitchell will be talking to neuroscientist Mr. Holsinger.
Well, anxiety is a condition that isn't developed or caused by a single factor, but rather by a combination of factors. So a number of factors play a role, including personality factors, difficult life experiences, and even physical health. Now, some individuals may have a family history of mental health conditions, and these may predispose them to anxiety attacks. Now, it is normal for us to be anxious some of the time. Anxiety is a normal part of life, so you might feel anxious when you're faced with a problem. You might feel anxious before you go into a test or while even writing a test, or even when you're making an important decision. But anxiety disorders involve more than temporary worry or fear. For anxiety to be medically diagnosed, you must have the symptoms, and I'll talk about them shortly, but you must have the symptoms for at least 6 months. So this is a chronic condition where you're feeling anxious most of the time, if not all the time, for around 6 months. And imagine that. Imagine yourself writing an exam every single day. You'll be feeling anxious every single day. And this goes on for long, long periods of time. So for a person with anxiety disorder, the anxiety does not go away. It can even get worse over time. And these feelings of anxiety can actually affect and interfere with your daily activities, such as performing a job, your schoolwork. It can even interfere with relationships. There are several different types of anxiety disorders, and we'll talk about some of the most common, which are general anxiety disorder and panic disorder, but there are many others, so you must keep that in mind. So next we'll look at the criteria for the diagnosis of generalized anxiety disorder, and these include excessive anxiety and worry about various events that have occurred more days than not for at least 6 months. Right, so in order to be diagnosed as having generalized anxiety disorder, this worry and anxiety has to be present for at least 6 months. The person finds it difficult to control the worry. The anxiety and the worry are associated with at least three of the following six symptoms. Those include restlessness or a feeling of being on edge, being easily fatigued, so we feel tired all the time, having difficulty concentrating, irritability, muscle tension, and sleep. Now, in children, you only need one of these symptoms in order to be diagnosed as having a generalized anxiety disorder. But in adults, you need at least three of those six that I just mentioned. The anxiety or worry or associated physical symptoms cause clinically significant distress or impairment in important areas of functioning. The disturbance is not due to a physiological effect or a substance or medical condition, and the disturbance is not better accounted for by another mental disorder. So these are the criteria in order to be diagnosed as having generalized anxiety disorder, and they're adapted from a document referred to as the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. And this is the rule book, if you like, for diagnosing individuals as having a medical condition. So next.
Yeah, thanks, Luke. I do believe there is a big link between the two. I believe that the geographical location and the wealth of people are important aspects when it comes to the quality healthcare, but also inequalities. And that can also lead to the development of mental illness. To begin with, geographical location plays an important role in determining the quality of services that you get. By living in rural areas, it's more likely that you're going to have outdated services, and it's hard to find quality access to hospitals, GPs, and also equipment. The reason for this is mainly because there is no reason for infrastructure like large hospitals or major hospitals to be built in these regions. So it basically means that if special treatment is needed, they need to be flown elsewhere to other major hospitals across Australia, which can put them at risk of developing a worse case of the disease or illness that they may be suffering from. And in terms of wealth, it also determines the access that you have to healthcare, because the more wealth you have, the better Medicare that can cover your surgeries and procedures. So the less wealth means you can't afford higher cover, which means you won't be able to afford certain surgeries that you pay for. The link that this has with mental illness is that there's been an increasing trend in people in rural areas developing mental illness. It was estimated that in rural areas, people are 2.4% more likely to suffer from mental illness, and they are more likely to commit suicide in comparison to metropolis areas. In 2010, almost 2,200 people died in rural areas because of suicide caused by depression. And this is quite obviously an alarming stat that needs to be addressed regarding the health of people living in disadvantaged areas, and nothing quite is being done to be able to help these people. It's also said that farmers have the highest suicide rates in the country, and this is brought on because of geographical location and the gap between people living in those disadvantaged areas and also with wealth. That's it.